So this basic pharmacology video is on seizure medications. So a seizure is a disturbance of electrical activity in the brain. There are several things that may cause seizures. An infectious disease may cause a seizure, such as meningitis. Drugs can cause seizures, some of your street drugs, your antipsychotics, theophylline. Some of those medications can cause seizures. Also, trauma may cause a seizure. A direct blow to the head can increase intracranial pressure and increase the risk for seizures. Metabolic disorders such as hypoglycemia or hyponatremia, low sodium, may cause a seizure. And seizures may also be idiopathic, and that means that they don't know why they happen. That cause is unknown. So there are various types of seizures. I won't go into the specifics on those, but there are partial seizures, and that is subdivided into simple and complex. There are generalized seizures, and those are absent, atonic, and tonic-clonic. Then there are special syndromes, and that can be febrile seizures, myoclonic seizures, and status epilepticus. I want to make a quick note just on the care of the client that has a seizure. Safety is going to be the key. We have to really make sure that a client is safe during a seizure. So if they're sitting or standing, we want to ease them to the floor. If they're in bed, we want to make sure the bed is in low position, that the side rails are up. Many times in facilities, they will put padded side rails on an individual's bed who has seizures or propensity to have seizures to keep them safe. As healthcare providers, if we witness a seizure, we always want to note what time the seizure happened and the duration of that seizure, how long it happened. I want to make some generalities about individuals who are on seizure medications, on how we give those and things that we want to think about. As with all medications, we want to make sure if a patient started on a seizure med or if they're taking one, that we have a complete list of all medications, including supplements and herbs, because of contraindications. And some of these mixes just don't work, so they may be dangerous. So we want to make sure we do that. We want to get a baseline vital sign on a patient that's on a seizure medication, know what we have to start with, and assess that level of consciousness. We want to ask the individual about pregnancy, if they're planning pregnancy. A lot of these medications are not for pregnancy. Back when we had categories, they're category C or category D. Many of them are category D, and I think that is just don't take, because they can have teratogenic effects. So if an individual is planning on getting pregnant, they definitely want to work with their healthcare provider, and they may want to change their medication up a little bit. So when we teach patients about anti-seizure medications, we want to definitely make sure they take them as directed and not stop them abruptly, because they can have a rebound seizure. We need to monitor blood levels of a lot of these seizure medications. So we need to teach our patient that. No grapefruit juice. Here's another one with grapefruit juice. That can increase the action of the seizure medication and then subsequently increase the risk of side effects and adverse effects. Also, individuals on seizure medications need to be taught to let their physician know or their dentist know if they're having surgery or any dental work. Let them know they're on these medications, because there may be an increased risk of bleeding. So how do seizure meds work? Well, the target is to control movement of electrolytes across that nerve membrane, or we want to affect neurotransmitter balance to prevent abnormal or repetitive firing. So how do we do that? Well, one way is to enhance GABA, or gamma aminobutyric acid. I was taught that GABA is like your mama. She quiets the nerves. She runs around and says, quiet, stop it. So gamma aminobutyric acid is an inhibitory neurotransmitter, and it quiets the brain down. We also can delay sodium influx. You know, sodium will increase the the action potential will make that nerve fire. So if we can calm those channels down, if we can delay those channels down, we can stop some of that abrupt nerve firing. Also, we can delay calcium influx. Without calcium, neurotransmission is impossible. So let's review some of our meds that increase GABA. We have barbiturates, benzodiazepines, and then we have other medications kind of that can potentiate GABA. I made a little mnemonic here. This is a very generalized statement about all of these medications that affect GABA. The way you can think about the side effects is think that your mama says, stop it. So I'm using the mnemonic STOP, S-T-O-P. So S is for sedation. These drugs can definitely make you tired, drowsiness, dizziness. Also, suicide. There's a basic principle about neurotransmitters. As one goes up, it may create another one to go down. So as we increase GABA, we may decrease serotonin. And serotonin is our happy girl. That's a neurotransmitter that has to do with mood. So that's why these medications can cause suicide. Second is for tremors or uncoordinated movement. That also is based on that neurotransmitter property where one goes up, one goes down. As we increase GABA, we may decrease the neurotransmitter dopamine. Dopamine is key for coordinated movement and also for pleasure. So if we decrease that, you know, individuals with Parkinson's have low dopamine, so they lose that coordinated movement. So those are others. That's another side effect you may see with GABA medicines. O is for optic changes. Believe it or not, there are GABA receptors in the eyes. So if these receptors are affected, then we may see side effects with these medications like blurred vision or nystagmus, things like that. So that's why that would happen. And lastly is P is for puzzled. Patients may have some, be puzzled or have some confusion when they take these medications. So that's a general principle to kind of think about with all these GABA medicines. So our first individual class of medicines that increase GABA are barbiturates. The main one, and this is an old drug, it's been around for a long time, is phenobarbital. Primidone is another one. You'll see that many of your barbiturates end in barbital. So that's a common drug ending, generic drug ending, that you may want to kind of look out for. Side effects are dependence with these drugs and significant CNS depression. So watch for sedation. Watch for respiratory depression. If we quiet that nerve, that brain down too much, that central nervous system down too much, patients can stop breathing. So those are the big things to watch for your barbiturates. The next class of medications that enhance GABA are benzodiazepines. Diazepam, which is brand name Valium, I'm sure everyone's heard of, and lorazepam, that's Ativan. These are two common medications we may use with seizures. Just to back up for a minute, just know that all these seizure medications, they work for different types of seizures and in different circumstances. So one doesn't cover all the tonic-clonic or absent or status epilepticus. We'll use different medications for different types of seizures. Benzodiazepines are good seizure medicines if the patient has a seizure in progress. If we have one that's happening, especially that status epilepticus where that seizure is not breaking or it's repeating and repeating, we may give these benzos, a lot of them are available IV or IM. So that's the route that we would use for those. These meds, of course, do come by mouth. They do come PO. Remember, these are scheduled IV, so they do have a propensity for addiction. We don't want these patients to stop these medications if they're taking it routinely, which usually they don't. This is usually an adjunct medication. And they can cause significant CNS depression. So again, watch your vital signs. Some of the other drugs that potentiate GABA, you notice there's GABA in the name. Gabapentin and pregabalin are a couple of them. Topiramate is another medication that increases GABA. You know, these GABA medications may also be used for, some of them may be used to treat neuropathy or nerve pain. And that makes sense if we can calm these nerves down, if we can quiet it down. Some of them may be beneficial for that. All right, we're going to cover a couple of the medications now that influence that sodium influx. So hydantoins are one of them that do that, and phenytoin is a common medication in that hydantoin class. Brand name is Dilantin. Tonin is a common ending for the generic drugs in this class, so you may see some of these other meds, and they do end in tonin. One of the common side effects of these medications are sedation, and also watch for gingival hyperplasia, and that's hypergrowth of the gum tissue. You can see it here in the picture a little bit. The gums actually can grow down over the teeth. So individuals that take this medication, it's really important that they learn to have really good oral care, that they brush their teeth and have real good oral care is going to be super important. These meds can cause hypotension, so watch for that. Adverse effects are neutropenia. So again, watch your complete blood count and watch those white blood cells, and also Stevens-Johnson syndrome. Phenytoin does have a narrow therapeutic effect, so we do want to monitor blood levels of phenytoin and make sure that we keep that in the therapeutic range. And these medications do decrease effectiveness of oral contraceptives. So we want to have the patient, if they're taking oral contraceptives, to use a backup method while they're on these drugs. Another phenytoin-related medication that influences sodium is valporic acid. I have the L in real big letters because you have to remember the liver on this. This drug is hepatotoxicity. So watch the patient for signs of this. That could be nausea, vomiting, jaundice, abdominal pain, and watch your liver function blood tests also to assess for liver function. So Val, watch your L. That means watch for your liver function. They can also increase the risk of pancreatitis. These drugs definitely are not recommended for pregnancy or for a woman that's breastfeeding. And think of safety with your older adult, too, because older adults may be a little more sensitive to this, so we may see a higher risk of side effects with our older adults. Other phenytoin-related medications. This can be carbamazepine, lamotrigine, and levotriacetam. One thing that you want to think about with carbamazepine is that it can cause blood dyscrasia. So watch your complete blood count. Watch that it can decrease the red blood cells, which would be anemia. It could decrease the white blood cells, which would be leukopenia. And it could decrease the platelets, which of course is thrombocytopenia. On the lamotrigine, watch for inflammation of the meninges. That would be a very serious effect of this medicine. So if your patient is complaining of headache or stiff neck, be aware of those side effects. Another class of medications for seizures, these are the ones that will affect calcium. Succinamides. So the real common one on that is ethosuximide, and this medication is only used for absent seizures. If you remember that absent seizures are seizures that only last for just seconds, a lot of time these seizures are misdiagnosed. We think it's ADHD or we think it's something else. So that's what this medication is used for. Common side effect is drowsiness, and an adverse effect would be neutropenia. Lastly, we have amino acid compounds. These also do affect that calcium influx. Acetylzolamide and locosamine, those are several drugs in that class. Drowsiness is a common side effect, and irregular heartbeat would be an adverse effect of these medicines. Well, that's it for your seizure medications. If you have any questions, please bring them to class.